Ciao! Here is a conversation with Angelo Cervone. Dr. Cervone is assistant professor at TU Delft and responsible of several courses given by the Aerospace Engineering faculty: aerospace design and system engineering elements, propulsion and power, spacecraft technology, micropropulsion. He holds a PhD in space propulsion at the University of Pisa, Italy, followed by a 2-year postdoc fellowship at Osaka University, Japan. He's author of more than 30 book chapters, contributions, and scientific articles, and more than 80 papers presented at international conferences. He is currently supervising 3 PhD candidates and has co-supervised 3 candidates who successfully completed their PhD in the past. He has been project manager or principal investigator for more than 10 research and development projects, mainly founded by the European Space Agency. Among other ones, he is currently principal investigator at TU Delft for LUMIO, an international cooperation for a CubeSat mission at the Lagrangian point L2, to observe and characterize micrometeoroid impacts on the lunar far side. I hope you enjoy it. To support this project, please subscribe to my YouTube channel, connect with me on Twitter and LinkedIn, and support me on Patreon with a monthly membership, following the links in the description. So thank you again for your time. Let me start by asking you if you can present yourself, your academic history, and how your research interests developed in time.
Sure. My name is Angelo Cervone. I'm Italian, as it is probably easy to understand from my English accent. At least I don't know for foreigners how it is, but for Italians, when we hear an Italian speaking in English, we understand instantly that he is Italian, or he or she is Italian. The accent is very, very clear. So I think also for foreigners, it's kind of easy to understand it. So I am currently working as an assistant professor at Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands, which is also the place from which I am participating in Stardust as a supervisor for one of our ESRs. And I have been working here for quite long, actually, because I started in 2012. So I am basically now in the 9th year here. So it's quite a long time. Before that, I was working in Italy. I actually studied at the University of Pisa in Italy quite long ago, actually. I started my university studies in 1992. And I also did a PhD in the same university. And I stayed in Pisa basically all the time, except 2 years when I did a postdoc in Japan at Osaka University. So I have also experienced a quite different working environment. It's a completely different working philosophy and style of working that they have in Japan.
Can you expand a bit on that? I'm curious about.
Well, it's kind of well known, actually. People are more or less aware of how it works there. The working philosophy in general, including working at university, is really giving a central place to work, in the sense that your work and your work environment is considered the kind of another family, and people have to really devote themselves to work, really to feel themselves as a part of a team in the work environment. I said have to, but it's not even an obligation. It's really a culture they have. Mm-hmm. So they do it because it's their culture, because they are obliged to do it. And this means that they spend a lot of time at work, that they give as often as possible, almost always actually, priority to work. And sometimes for us it's difficult to do the same kind of thing, because for us we tend to also give importance to family and to separate very clearly the time that we spend with family and the time that we spend at work, while in that culture, if work needs it, you need to tell your family, okay, look, I have to go and to spend more time at work. So for Western people, it's difficult sometimes to get used to that system. It was a bit different because it was a temporary thing. It was just a 2-year postdoc, so I didn't have to completely adapt myself to it. It was tolerated that I had a different mentality. But if you go there for longer and you really work there, then you really have to adapt yourself, which is not easy.
I see.
It's a nice experience. You learn that there are also different cultures and different working than what you are used to.
Okay, and after Japan?
Then I went back to Italy and I continued working. Actually, I did my PhD also working at the same time in a SME that was a spin-off of the university. So I was already working there during PhD and I continued working there after the postdoc in Japan. I was a project manager of several projects related to space propulsion, mostly funded by the European Space Agency.
Okay, and then you went to Delft.
Yeah, because in Italy I had some part-time activities in the university. I was lecturing in some courses, supervising some students, but I really wanted to have a full academic career with a full-time job at university. So when I realized that this was difficult to realize in Italy, then I started looking for other options and I found a good job here in Delft. So this is why I moved.
Okay, nice. So you mentioned your area of research, propulsion, and I know from your research, let's say, portfolio, that you're particularly focused on micropropulsion. Can you give us a definition of what that is?
I believe there is not really a consolidated definition, at least I never found a definition in literature. So every person has their own definition. Basically, micro, which means very small, can mean two different things. It can mean very small in terms of size, of course, but it can also mean very small in terms of trust level. And in some cases, it's both. Of course, very small is really engineering definition because it is not easily quantifiable. We could more or less put it in the range of centimeters or less in terms of dimension and in the range of milli to micronewtons in terms of thrust, but it's not really a consolidated. So it might happen that some people define as micropropulsion things that are also slightly larger than this. So it's mainly a big umbrella under which we place all the propulsion concepts that need the significant miniaturization. And then this means also all the challenges associated to miniaturizing the propulsion systems.
I see. And I'm curious about that. Is the field of micropropulsion emerged as a consequence of the rise of miniaturized satellites like CubeSats? Or is it a field that has a richer history, a older history, maybe coming from outside the space engineering arena?
Yeah, if we talk about size, this is mainly a consequence of the miniaturization of spacecraft. Because, of course, you needed also to miniaturize everything, all the subsystems, in order to make them fit into the smaller size. If we talk about thrust level, not always, because there has always been a need, also in the past, also before the starting of the new miniaturization trends in spacecraft, for having very small thrust levels that are needed for very precise maneuvering for spacecraft, for example, that need very accurate pointing of the spacecraft and so on. So there have been actually in the past, even before the rise of CubeSats and small spacecraft, propulsion systems developed, which were designed in order to deliver thrust levels very small, in the order of micronewton, and not only very small, but also very precisely adjustable, because that is also the most important point that you need if you want to point a spacecraft accurately. But those systems, there was not really a need to make them small. So they could also be a bit larger. So part of the challenges related to miniaturization in that case were at least mitigated.
I see. Can you give us the challenges associated to miniaturization, both the old ones, let's say, the ones associated to low thrust and to...
Well, it can be summarized in one sentence, that is, it is not possible in general in engineering, but in propulsion especially, it's not possible to just take a system that is larger and scale it down as it is and make a smaller one. This would be very nice, but it doesn't work like that. And the reason is that all the performance parameters of a propulsion system don't scale linearly with size. This is different depending on the type of propulsion. For example, if we talk about electric propulsion, what happens is that when you make an electric thruster smaller, you have more losses in percent compared to what you have in larger system, because it is not as efficient as the larger one. And this means that the power that you need to operate the system does not scale linearly. And this means in turn that very small electric propulsion system have thrust to power ratio that normally are much worse than the larger ones. And this explains why when you use an electric propulsion system in a small spacecraft or in a CubeSat, you can use it only at extremely low thrust levels, because otherwise you would not have enough power. In the case of a chemical system or a system in general where you accelerate the propellant, not electrically, but thermodynamically in a nozzle, in that case, the scaling problems come from fluid dynamics. So basically you are making your nozzle smaller and smaller, and at a certain point, the Reynolds number inside the nozzle becomes too small, and you have extremely big losses again in terms of boundary layers in the nozzle. Basically, you are not able anymore to accelerate the entire flow as you do in a larger system. And this is the reason why in some systems, sometimes even they try to remove the nozzle and to have the acceleration happening with other systems that are a bit less conventional, like, for example, making the particles of the gas bounce in the walls and being accelerated by the collisions instead of the shape of the nozzle. So as a consequence of all of this, you basically need to change your philosophy and change your design. As I said, you cannot just take a large system, make all the dimensions smaller, and it will work. This is not how it works. And you will see if you take a micropropulsion book that many of the concepts that are proposed for very small propulsion are completely different than what you have for larger ones, exactly because of this.
I see. And also about components, is there a relation with the miniaturization of satellites? I mean, is micropropulsion characterized by commercial off-the-shelf components, or is that something not that?
Yes and no. If we talk about the thruster itself, that normally needs to be designed more or less from scratch, for the reasons that I told you, because you have to adapt your design and your type of propulsion to the requirements that you have, depending on how much thrust you need, how much specific impulse you need, and so on. But in the propulsion system, there are also other components. There are valves, there are pipelines, tanks, and so on. And normally, you try to use commercial off-the-shelf components as much as you can for these other parts. It's not always possible, but when possible, of course, it's preferred. So, yeah, it depends. It's partially done, but not completely. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let me shift to the work you do inside Stardust Reloaded Network. Yeah. I saw your latest publication. Let me read it out. Novel 3U standalone CubeSat architecture for autonomous near-Earth asteroid flyby. Quite a long title. Also authored by Stefano Casini, one of the early stage researchers of our network. Can you present the work?
Well, I would say it's mainly authored by him because it's basically his work. I contributed just in as a supervisor, but he was the one who did the work and wrote most of the paper. It's a very interesting paper, actually, because in this paper, that is kind of the first step in the work of Stefano as a ESR of Stardust, he analyzed what are the possibilities for using very small spacecraft for deep space exploration, basically. So what he did, he considered a sample mission. In this case, the sample mission was a flyby mission to an asteroid in which a spacecraft does not go to the asteroid and stays there, but just has a trajectory that allows the spacecraft to go close to the asteroid, see it for a certain time, and then, of course, fly away from it. And he used the requirements of this sample mission to check how small can be a spacecraft that can fulfill these requirements. And he found out that in principle, it might be possible to do this with a 3U CubeSat. That means a spacecraft with a size of 10 by 10 by 30 centimeters. So it's really a small one. This is done still keeping a lot of good functionalities for the spacecraft, because in the end, you would have the possibility with this spacecraft to travel autonomously from a transfer orbit around the Earth to the asteroid, and to do this completely in an autonomous way, so without the need of any support from Earth, from the ground station, and to get some useful scientific data when the spacecraft arrives at the asteroid by using a payload that is made of a small camera and a spectrometer. So it's possible basically to get some very basic information on the surface characteristics of the asteroid, which would already give some very good scientific insight into how the asteroid looks like. And if you combine this with the fact that you're doing it with a very small spacecraft, which means also a very cheap spacecraft, we are talking of probably two orders of magnitude less cost than a mission that you do with a larger spacecraft. You understand why it is very attractive. You can get very good scientific information with a lot less money. And at the same time, you can use these missions also to demonstrate technology, to improve our design of some specific components, and so on. So I believe this was a very nice work. It is all on paper. Unfortunately, it's not something that has been done in practice yet. But from what the analysis of Stefano has shown, there seem to be no big showstoppers to do it also in practice. So it would be very nice if we would have an opportunity to try something like this in the future.
Mm-hmm. And there's a, let's say, a business case for this, because you mentioned the scaling of the price. there's also, I guess, a scaling in the scientific return one can expect.
There is not a real business case. Of course, there is a scaling in the scientific return because you don't have an unlimited space in the spacecraft. You cannot put all the instrumentation that you would like to. But still, one thing that you could do, for example, is to have different spacecrafts going all to the same asteroid with different instrumentation. So it would still be possible in principle to...
And that would compensate the use of small satellites compared to...
And the most important point is that this design makes the spacecraft completely autonomous. So far, there are only two CubeSats that have gone outside the Earth-Moon system that are the Marco CubeSat from NASA. And those were not autonomous. They were flying together with a larger mission and they were relying quite heavily on the other parts of that mission to work. In this case, it would be a spacecraft that is released by a launcher in an Earth orbit and from there does the mission completely autonomously. So it's quite one step farther compared to what has been done so far.
I see. And from a system engineering perspective, can you talk about the challenges of going interplanetary with small satellites? I saw you have papers not only going to near Earth asteroids, but also the Moon and Mars, as you said now.
We are also involved in a mission for a CubeSat to Mars, to the Moon, for example. Recently, we have participated in studies also for Mars CubeSats. In all of these CubeSats, the main problem, not surprisingly actually, is the volume budget. There are not really big problems with the mass. You can stay relatively easily within the mass budgets and the mass limitations that you have. Even power, it's challenging, but it's doable because nowadays you have these very nice foldable solar panels that can stay in a relatively low volume and then be unfolded in space and collect quite a lot of power. But the real problem is the volume because this, especially CubeSats, are standardized. You cannot make them the shape that you like. And they are standardized not only in shape, but also in size. You have very specific types of size from which you can choose. And it's not easy at all to fit everything in that shape and in that size. What I have seen, at least in studies to which I have participated, is that the volume budget was the most difficult to close basically in every case. And in some cases, you really had to make difficult choices, like removing some instrumentation, for example, or accepting compromises in the performance of the spacecraft. One compromise that is often done, and it's not often liked by traditional spacecraft designers, is to remove a lot of redundancies. Redundancies are very important for spacecraft design because they allow to mitigate the consequences of possible failures. And this is especially important for spacecraft to go very far away to deep space missions. And if you start removing redundancies, that means that there might be cases when a failure of a specific component cannot be taken over by other components. And you are accepting the compromise that if a failure occurs, then you will lose the mission. Many people are not very happy with this, but sometimes you have to do it, otherwise you don't fit your body.
Mm-hmm. And the challenges for Moon, Mars are the same, or they're specific?
Well, I would say as long as you go to outside Earth orbit, you have more or less the same issues. What changes is In case you want to make your spacecraft autonomous, the farther you go, the more propellant you need, the more delta V you need, and so the more propellant you need, meaning that you will need a propulsion system that takes a larger part of the spacecraft. But this is typically independent on the size, because it is in percent of the size of the spacecraft. So whatever is the size, the farther you go, the more percent of this size will be needed for propulsion.
I see. Well, I thank you for your time, and I thank you for your work in the Stardust Network. And I thank hope you gave a clear overview of what you're doing in the network.
Thank you very much, and thank you for this interview. It was very interesting to talk about my research.